Thank you for coming out tonight. My name is Councillor Gary Flynn, and I want to just introduce the council for anybody that doesn't know them, Mayor Wendy LeBlanc, Councillor Louis Antonakis, Councillor Rob Probert, Councillor Doug Black. We have two councillors that are not with us tonight, Deputy Mayor Sonnenberg and Councillor Gary Strike. We'll go ahead with the meeting. Anyone with pecuniary interest may declare it now or any time during the meeting. Anyone wishing to speak may register with the secretary. I think we have a couple that are registered already. Do we have their names, Dave?
Yeah, we currently have two individuals registered to speak tonight, Dr. David Stevenson and Lisa Michaud.
Please turn off all cell phones and pagers, and I don't, have we got an agenda for tonight's meeting?
No.
Thank you. Our first order of business tonight, and what I'm sure all of you are here for, is the fluoride issue. And that is item 122418. And it's an item that I brought forward first term of council and again in September of 2011. As a result of this, we're here tonight to, with two sides of the debate, to present their views. And the summary is the medical officer of health has offered to meet the council to discuss fluoride in the water. And our update one, previous discussions on this matter led to the possibility of bringing in a proponent to have fluoride removed and an advocate of fluoride such as the medical officer of health. Information has been provided by the committee chair to members of council, and do we still need proponents of both positions to make a determination. And the update two, Dr. Paula Stewart, the Lanark Leeds and Grenville Medical Officer of Health will provide information to the committee from a position as an advocate of fluoridation of drinking water. And joining Dr. Paula Stewart is Dr. Cooney, who is the Chief Dental Officer of County. Robert J. Fleming, President of Canadians Opposed to Fluoride, will provide information to the committee from a position as advocate to the removal of fluoride from the town's drinking water. And joining Robert Fleming will be Sheldon Thomas, professional in the field of drinking water. And a comment, the committee has indicated that the session will be for educational purposes only, and the decision to move forward with the plebiscite will be determined in the future. Should the committee determine to move forward with a plebiscite, it will need to be determined no later than April 2014. Now, upon further investigation of the matter, it has been determined that fluoridation can be discontinued by the establishment of a bylaw. It means we don't necessarily need a plebiscite. To say that this is a contentious issue would be a major understatement. Many communities over the years throughout the world have been in the same position as we in Carleton Place are right now, seeking to make an informed decision as to whether to continue the practice of adding artificial fluoridation to our water. Windsor has been the most recent large city in Canada to remove fluoride from the water. And an interesting point is that Montreal does not fluoridate their water, and Toronto does. We're here tonight to listen to both sides of the debate and hopefully leave here with enough knowledge to continue the search for the right answer. First up tonight will be Dr. Stewart speaking, and as I said, on the pro side of fluoridation. I would ask that any questions that you have, please wait until after both sides have spoken. There'll be ample time. We hope there'll be ample time for people to have to contribute with their questions and get as much knowledge as you can before you leave here tonight. Dr. Stewart?
Is this on?
Yep.
Thank you very, very much for the invitation to speak today. And I really applaud you for having the education section. I agree with you 100%. This is such a complex topic that I think decisions shouldn't be taken lightly, but we should consider the whole, all of the issues. What I'm hoping that I'll do today is explore some of those issues with you. When I was preparing the presentation, I asked Mary LeBlanc what information counselors would like. So I'm hoping I'm going to provide you with the information you've asked me for. And I asked Counselor Flynn what was the information he wanted. And he said, I want to know why you still support it in spite of the evidence or something like that. Which I think is very reasonable. Because I think we all should have our scientific hats on when we talk about water and fluoridation. So if I haven't answered your questions, please let me know. We will provide written answers to any of the ones that are related. The reason I put the people on the first slide is because fundamentally, that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about how does Carleton Place promote the dental health of its residents so that every single one of those people has a healthy smile, and all 10,000 people in Carleton Place have a healthy smile. So that's really what this is all about. I think the council is faced with four questions. The first one is the dental health of residents in this community improved by adding fluoride to the water to the recommended levels? That's the first question I think you're faced with. The second one is who benefits from it. The third one is it cost effective? That's a huge big issue for all the municipalities in our region. And does it cause any problems to the residents, the water system, or the ecosystem? So those are the questions I think that you're facing and that I'm hoping to answer today. We had multitudinous numbers of people who collaborated on preparing the presentation. And we've actually prepared a written document that outlines everything that I and Dr. Cooney are going to say. And we'll have copies of them at the back for anyone who's interested in it. And the counselors, you have it at your table now. I'm really pleased that Bob LeBlanc, who's the operations manager at the water plant, welcomed Becky Cavanaugh, one of our managers, and I. And so he took us through the whole water plant so we could really understand it from that perspective. I'm really pleased that Jim Mahoney, who's with the Ministry of the Environment, is here, because I think this is so complex that we need people coming from many different angles. So you can see all the people who've been involved. Why is dental health important? I think every single one of us can answer that. If you don't have good dental health and you have cavities, you have pain, you have tooth loss. My husband was at the dentist yesterday and had a root canal, and he said it was either pull the tooth or the root canal. And our teeth are incredibly important to us. If you lose teeth, it affects your self-esteem. It actually affects whether or not you can be employed. People that go into an interview without having a healthy smile have a much harder time getting a job than those who do. So it's not just nice to have, dental health is critical. If you don't have healthy teeth, you can't eat well, and so you don't have healthy nutrition. And there's a lot of information that says that if you have infection in your mouth, that you're more likely to have heart disease, respiratory disease, and even preterm birth. So dental health is absolutely essential for our overall health. So, what's the research? I'm a physician, I'm a scientist. I'm coming at this whole question as a researcher. Does fluoride in drinking water promote dental health? Fluoride is actually, it's in our water, it's in our air, it's in the soil. At the Carleton Place plant, I think the water comes in with about 0.1 milligram per liter or so. The recommended level is 0.5, so a small amount is added to get it to that recommended level. And what fluoride does, it has two benefits. The first one is that when children ingest fluoride, when the adult teeth are forming, it actually helps to make the teeth so that the enamel is really, really strong. And for children and adults, then what it helps to do is repair the enamel, because the fluoride gets absorbed into the body and into the saliva, and then it bathes it up, and so it helps to repair the enamel, which is destroyed by the acid and so on. Fluoride is most effective.
Mr. Chair, could you address the issue of placards being placed in front of the speaker as she was trying to articulate to council this evening?
Please refrain from doing that. We'll give you a chance to make your points. Thanks.
So there's a lot of research that supports this, and if you have any questions about that, I'd be happy to prepare a written documentation for you. Okay, so that's why fluoride is. Who does it benefit? The nice thing about having fluoride in water is that it benefits everybody. In Carleton Place, young children are benefited because it's really hard for them to brush their teeth. Well, the Canadian Pediatric Society highlights this and says this is the reason why it's really important that kids have fluoride in water to help repair the damage that the teeth is undergoing. And in Carleton Place, 40% of the residents don't have any dental insurance, which means it's incredibly expensive to go to the dentist. And a lot of those people will not go for the preventive dental care, which is critical for our health and health. And while topical fluoride, like varnishes, helps just as fluoride in the water does, it's only accessible to those people who actually go to the dental office, and it's a much more expensive way to provide the fluoride than it is directly into the water. So all the Carleton Place residents benefit from it. And a lot of the discussion about water fluoridation is an equity issue, that it's important that all of our residents have healthy teeth. And water fluoride reaches everyone, so that's really, really important. Is it cost effective? Research shows that for every dollar spent in water fluoridation, it saves $38 in dental treatment. And that the lifetime cost of fluoride are the same as the cost of one filling. Carleton Place Water Plant costs, the fluoride costs between $10,000 and $20,000 per year. Out of a $500,000 budget. So that's for an average Carleton Place person, that's about $1 per resident per year. Pretty cost effective. What are the benefits and are there any health concerns? And I'd like to invite Dr. Cooney to come in and talk about that from the Health Canada Public Health Agency perspective.
Sorry?
Is my prohibition to not
make placards? No, please don't. We should not have that.
And thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Stewart. It's a pleasure to be here with you tonight in this lovely building. And you certainly have some nice buildings out here in this lovely area, so I'm very pleased to be here. What I'm going to do is talk to you more from a national perspective. Touch on some of the areas that Dr. Stewart touched on, but also kind of move forward a little bit in some of the particular areas that we want to address tonight. What I would like to emphasize is that the Health Canada Public Health Agency obviously doesn't get involved directly in these decisions. These are municipal decisions, and we respect that. So we come up as an information session like this if we're asked to represent science. And I can tell you all here tonight, science is very, very solid and supporting water fluoridation, and that's what I hope to present to someone here tonight. As Dr. Stewart mentioned, I think we're talking a little bit more here than just teeth. We're talking about health, where if you have a healthy mouth and you can eat and your nutrition is good, then you will, in all likelihood, have the chance of having a healthy body. So we're not just looking at enamel and teeth, we're looking at overall health. When you talk about chronic disease risk factors, one of the issues you can see is if you take a kid or an adolescent, you pop them in front of the television and you give them chips and pop, two things will happen. Their teeth will rot from the pop they will get obese. If they get obese, you run into diabetes, you run into cardiovascular issues, you run into a whole series of chronic diseases. So the key here, when we're talking about teeth, is that we're talking about health. What I want to talk to you specifically, though, is what Health Canada did in 2006. There was a large review commenced on water fluoridation, and I think this should help to put your minds at ease, that there was a very, very extensive review done. It took almost 5 years, and it was done with three reviewers who reviewed systematic reviews in the literature. These were peer-reviewed by three more reviewers. Then there was an expert panel put together to determine what the position in terms of fluoride should be in relation to Canada. I'm jumping a little bit to the findings and recommendations because obviously our time is very limited. What I have done here, and I will leave this presentation with you, is I've left references within the body of the text. So if you want to look at anything, if you want to refer to anything, please feel free. The references should take you through to what you want to see. Basically, what was recommended was that Canada stays at a maximum allowable concentration of 1.5 parts per million, and that the optimal level of fluoride in the water be 0.7 parts per million to give the best oral health and dental benefit. Now, the range here in Ontario, as you probably know, is 0.5 to 0.8, so you're bang on there with that 0.7 optimum. On the process, and you will hear criticism, various criticisms, and it doesn't, I guess, matter what you do, you're likely to be criticized, but that's fair if you can address the criticisms, and we can with this process. It was very fair. The Commissioner of the Environment is familiar with these types of processes, and those environmental concerns were also considered in this. And he basically identified that this was a very, very fair but lengthy process. He did point out that these processes usually do take about 5 years and are very lengthy, but do give positive results in that you get straight to the science. The science basically indicated that when you look at water fluoridation, that there are no health concerns, particularly when it is at an optimum health level, which is the 0.5 to 0.8 range. You will hear probably tonight that it causes fluorosis. We did a national survey, the Canadian Health Measure Survey. We looked at fluorosis in terms of teeth to determine if there was fluorosis in Canada. What you can see through the Canadian Health Measure Survey, operated by Statistics Canada, Health Canada, and the Department of National Defence, was you do not have a concern with moderate and severe fluorosis in Canada, which are the areas of fluorosis that would cause an individual concern. There were basically three kids from of about 1,200 kids with fluorosis. When we followed up with these kids, we found that they were from other countries, two were from China, one was from India. So what I can tell you, if you're hearing that fluoride causes fluorosis in the water, in terms of moderate or severe damage to teeth, that is not correct. And this study very, very clearly showed that. What I popped up there for you to see is the level of water fluoridation in Canada in 1961, and then in 2009, I believe, and the levels next door are the levels of caries. And basically what you can see is as water fluoridation in Canada went up, the caries went down. Are there other causes for that? Yes. Visits to dental offices have given tremendous improvement. But what is the one equalizer? What is the one factor that gets to all people, whether they're rich or poor? What we call the great leveler is water fluoridation. In the water, it is safe, it is a good level, and it has a major dental benefit. It does not have health concerns, and I would emphasize that fact. If you want to go into the details of this, you will get the details. The expert review group looked at developmental concerns, IQ issues, neurotoxicity, developmental toxicity, osteoporosis. There is a list of the health concerns that they looked at. They did not find conclusive evidence that there were problems associated with water fluoridation and any of these problems. Now, what I put up then finally is the conclusion, which is basically Health Canada and the public health agencies strongly support and are comfortable with the use of water fluoridation. The message on the bottom is from our Chief Medical Officer of Health, who's Dr. David Butler Jones, also very, very comfortable with it. If I want to leave you with a take-home message from this little part, and I'll pass this back to Dr. Stewart now. My message would be, if you have health concerns in relation to water fluoridation, you do not have to worry. My message would be, does it work? Yes, it does. Large numbers of systematic reviews included in those references that I gave you here very clearly indicate that it is effective, it is cost effective. The number of $38 saved for every $1 spent on water fluoridation continually recurs. That is a good number, comes from the CDC in the States. And you are going to hear issues associated with the chemical that's used, hydrofluorosilicic acid. I can tell you that that dissociates once it gets to water. So if there are concerns that you're receiving that from the tap, you're not. It dissociates into fluoride, it dissociates into silicon, it dissociates into hydrogen ions. And that is a guaranteed fact, and it has been studied by the European Commission, by the SHEER, a committee by the name of Scientific Committee on Environmental Health Risks of the EU, very clearly came out of that information. So that is another concern you will hear, and I can tell you that there's good science to support the fact that it is safe in the water. That's about it for me, and I'm happy to answer questions later on.
Thank you, Dr. Good.
They can't possibly get fluorosis.
And to get fluorosis, you have to have regular long-term exposure. And infants aren't fed a lot of auto formulas for very long, and by 6 months they're adding other food. So I'm not concerned about that at all. Nor is the Canadian Pediatric Society or Health Canada. So what's the effect on the water system and the ecosystem? I'm curious about some of the concerns where, because you promised you would repeat that. And so I went onto your websites and looked at what you're doing, and I'm really interested in hearing what you're going to say to us tonight. And fluoride is obtained from the same rocks where the phosphates are obtained that are used in the fluoride and the fertilizer industry. So there's talk about that it's actually a byproduct of the fertilizer industry. It isn't. They're in the same rocks, and so when it's processed, then you end up with the fluoride on one side and the others on the other side. So I think that's really important to know. Fluoride is put into a compound called hydrofluorosilicic acid, so it's transported. I went to the water plant here in Carleton, which is incredibly impressive. Had a whole tour of the system. It is so carefully monitored. They have computer screens that constantly say how much fluoride is in the water. If it goes too high, there's an alarm. Like, it's so well done, and Bob, who managed it, was just so proud of this system. So then I think that's really important to know. As Peter said, Dr. Cooney said, as soon as the hydrofluorosilicic acid is added to the water, it immediately separates into its components. And the fluoride is exactly the same as the fluoride that's in the water when it came into the water plant. And so there's no risk of being exposed to that. If you had contact with the chemical itself, there'd be a problem that you don't, which is why the water plant all shows they have to be incredibly careful to make sure that the people who work with it don't have a problem. As I said, the fluoride is very carefully monitored. I spoke to the people who actually manufacture, Rentec manufacture the HFSA, and they have to follow very rigid rules in terms of how it's prepared. They have to measure what's in it. They measure actually on the points that it actually moves from place to place before it gets to the problem water plant. And the water plant has to do tests on the water every year and produce a water report, which are all on your website. And they describe what the chemicals are and what the metals are. And one of the concerns is arsenic. I can report to you that you have no problem with arsenic. Your water report for 2011 and 12 show undetectable levels. So there's so many safeguards, because the Ministry of the Environment, it creates an incredible number of safeguards to make sure that the water you get is safe for drinking. And your Carleton water plant is as good as any of the other ones. Another question was, do municipalities have the legislative authority for water fluoridation? The answer is yes. So I asked the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care. And each municipality is licensed by the Ministry of the Environment to operate a water plant. There are very detailed requirements, and Jim O'Connor can answer any of the questions you might have about that. In 1961, the Ontario Fluoridation Act was passed because the Drinking Water Act from before hadn't been clear about whether it was okay for municipalities to add fluoridated fluoride to water or not. And so this is the act that gives the municipalities the authority to do it. And then the 2002 Safe Drinking Water Act, it says that the councils need to be very careful about the decisions they make about the water system, because they have a responsibility to their residents. And a legal opinion on that act from the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care says that if the councillors listen to wise advice from experts, then they are totally within their right to have fluoride to water. So you do not have to worry that you're contributing any kind of legislation. And there are standards and operational requirements so that they have to be published, which is really, really important. So what about choice? You know, I'm a public health physician. My responsibility is to look at the health of the population and identify interventions that are going to make a difference. And we have a history in Canada of things like vitamin D in milk for rickets, so kids don't have rickets, and iodine in salt for goiters. Ottawa Valley used to be placed with people who had very big goiters in the past. The reason those mechanisms were chosen, and the reason fluoride in water is chosen, is because it's the most cost-effective way to help all the people in the population. Okay? And that's a Canadian value that we have, that we're going to help everyone in the population, not only people who can afford it. And residents can choose to remove the fluoride from their water systems if they want to. The methods have actually been used for places that have very high levels of fluoride, and they want to make sure that people aren't overexposed. So that's always possible. As Dr. Cooney said, there are many organizations who support water fluoridation, so you are in good company in terms of fluoridating water that you have right now. And these organizations have reviewed all the evidence that Dr. Cooney talked about and believe that water fluoridation is a really, really important public health measure. So I won't read them all, you can go through them. One of the counselors asked what's happening in Ontario communities right now. So this is the information that our whole team put together, and hopefully it's what you were looking for. So 75% of Ontarians right now benefit from water fluoridated to recommended levels. There are other municipalities that are doing exactly the same thing you're doing, and I think that's your due diligence. When there are concerns out there, I think your due diligence is to do exactly this. Collect the information and so that you're comfortable with the decision that you're making. So the ones on the top, this is in the last 5 years, have all done the exact same review you're doing, looking at the exact same evidence. And you can see Smith Falls did this in 2011, I think. Actually, Rockville looked at it in 2011 as well in the Finance Committee, and they decided to continue with water fluoridation. So those are local. And you can see Halton, Hamilton, London, Muskoka, and so on. By far, the majority of communities who take a look at this, analyze the evidence, decide to continue with water fluoridation. There are some who haven't. So the summary is that how place you've been contributing to dental health for your residents for over 50 years. That's really, really important. Water fluoridation at the recommended levels, which is critical. It's like many other chemicals in the body. Too much is a problem. The right amount is really, really beneficial. It's safe. It's sensible. It's the best cavity fighter we have. It's the easiest to use. It's affordable. Less than a dollar per resident per year. It's fair. It benefits all members of the community, from children to seniors. It's effective. Still probably has a 30% protective effect, even with all the other things that, that we have given to us. Thank you. I really appreciate that people have come out tonight. It is fundamentally, as Dr. Cooney said, about promoting the health of the residents in our community. And municipalities have a wonderful opportunity to have a major impact on that way that really won't last that. So thank you. And be very happy to have any questions. If there's anything we haven't addressed, be happy to receive the questions and then give a response in writing. So thank you.
Could we just wait till we have our second presentation and we have all the questions at the end, if you don't mind, please. While we're taking a minute, I was remiss in not introducing Dave Young, our Director of Public Works and Secretary of the Physical Environment Committee. Thank you, Stuart. We'll have who's going to come? You going to come first? Sheldon Thomas is going to come up and speak first.
Can you hear me if I put this thing right here? Perfect. Good evening, Mayor LePlanc, Chairman Flynn, and councilors, residents. My name is Sheldon Thomas. I'm a retired manager of the City of Hamilton's water distribution system. I've worked for about 38 years trying to keep drinking water safe out of taps and trying to patch the old pipes. It gets it there. For most of those years, I never gave fluoridation a second chance. It was just one of those things that cities did to add something to the water to protect the teeth. As a water professional, I am now a little bit embarrassed to learn that I did not understand enough about the downside of water fluoridation and the water I was providing. Excuse me, I have a bit of a cold. But even though I didn't understand that, I had lots of room, lots of company in my ignorance. I was surprised to learn that until about the mid-80s, most of the scientists at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, regarded fluoridation exactly the same as I did. Like everyone else, EPA scientists assumed that fluoridation had been thoroughly studied by others and that it presented no problems. Then in 1985, EPA administration tried to force a staff scientist to write that it was okay for kids to have white spots on their teeth. Now, of course, the white spots identify dental fluorosis, which is a marker of excessive fluoride intake. EPA administration wanted to classify dental fluorosis as a harmless cosmetic condition, trying to avoid a classification called an adverse health effect. Now, the scientist under pressure knew better. He knew that ingested fluoride interferes with the natural formation of tooth enamel. The white spots and streaks that result are areas where the enamel has become porous and brittle. He saw this as an injury to the tooth. And the larger body of the EPA scientists thought so too. And at that point, they started studying fluoridation, perhaps for the first time ever, and very, very closely. Soon enough, this body of 1,500 scientists were convinced that there was little or no dental benefit, and there were strong indications that ingesting fluoridated water would cause injuries throughout the body. Now, 15 years later, EPA scientists appeared before the U.S. Congress to appeal for a moratorium on water fluoridation, based upon their findings of probable harm and lack of benefit. Who knew that there was this dogfight going on between the EPA administration and the scientists in their employ? And why do these government scientists feel compelled to sound the alarm against water fluoridation? Counselors, you're in an unpleasant position of having to decide just where to place your trust in this matter. I get that. Your first reflex is to turn to local health authorities, and they will supply you with information that's often provided to you by their larger associations. And in the matter of water fluoridation, they'll probably cite a lot of information provided by Health Canada. In this, you have the right to expect that public health should know the nuts and bolts about water fluoridation. But isn't that exactly what the EPA scientists thought 30 years ago? They trusted that public health and dental associations had conducted thorough scientific evaluation of the health effects of swallowing fluoridation chemicals. Now, before any chemical or product is made available for human consumption, it must be subjected to a rigorous examination. Specifically, toxicology studies involving animal tests and later, if possible, clinical trials on humans and human volunteers. It must also be established that it will do as advertised. If this target chemical survives that kind of scrutiny, then it can be considered safe. That kind of scientific scrutiny has never been applied to the fluoridating chemical in your water. Despite the obvious risks, a number of organizations have lined up to convince you that you should drink the water anyway. They're all on a long list, is that basically circulated by the American Dental Association. They have titles that are very heavy with seeming authority. Now, the list was created to calm your fears and to deflate your curiosity about water fluoridation. Each organization is essentially telling you this: when you swallow fluoridated drinking water, you will suffer no adverse health effects anywhere throughout your body, ever, and you will enjoy substantial dental benefits for a lifetime. Each of them is saying that. Since the list is so often presented by proponents of fluoridation, let's you and I have a look at who's there. There are 47 dental organizations on the list. None of them has the authority to be there. Even the California Board of Dental Examiners admitted 14 years ago that deciding whether or not fluoridation causes any ill effects throughout the body, throughout the outside of the oral cavity area, is not within the purview of dentistry. Therefore, not within the purview of dentistry. Dental schools do not teach how water fluoridation affects bodily tissue outside of the oral cavity. For the fluoride ion to make its way to the area of the mouth, it has to ride the bloodstream. And in the blood, it visits every nook and cranny of your body. And it does not behave itself on the way. How can anyone in dentistry claim that fluoridation is safe, yet know nothing about what the fluoride ion is up to in the blood vessels between the stomach and the teeth? Case in point is the new claim that fluoride prevents cavities by disrupting the enzymes of oral cavity bacteria. But those who make that claim are utterly silent on the likelihood that the same fluoride ion will corrupt enzymes in other systems of the body. Now, just as silent, unfortunately, are all the medical associations on that list. They must certainly know what biochemists have known for a long time, that fluoride is an enzyme poison. And the poisoning of enzymes is one of the reasons why animals and plants sicken and die. What is remarkable, what is inescapable, is that fluoridation proponents are inviting you to drink water that contains an established fluoride or enzyme poison. They claim, will claim over and over, that its concentration is so low that you can drink it, you can cook with it, you can bathe in it for your lifetime and suffer no harm. Unfortunately, there is no proof of any of that. What is also remarkable is that they see nothing wrong with asking you to risk dental fluorosis, the permanent structural damage of teeth, all to prevent statistically half a cavity. No one on the list appears to have any substantial proof that fluoridation is, or ever was, a good idea. And then there are people on the list such as the Chocolate Manufacturers Association, and also the National Confectioners Association, whose motto is making life sweeter since 1885.